All right, Ivan, how are you today?
Very good, very good. It's tour. Very busy
Everything
lately.
well?
So far, so good. Can't complain. How are you, my
Working
friend?
hard, you say?
Unfortunately, so.
Working hard or hardly working?
I know, working hard, working hard. I
All
know that in
right, good,
Spanish,
good,
but
good.
come on, those things don't apply to everybody, you know. Generalizations are
No,
not
no.
always good.
No. Spanish people work hard. That's a stereotype that people don't work hard. People put in the hours. That's right, especially in the corporate culture. Yes, that's it.
Exactly. How have you been? Have you had your
Not too
first
bad.
full run of the season?
No, because I don't normally eat them even at Christmas time, so I wouldn't start eating them early. They're not one of my favorite things, to be honest, Ivan. I like a few of the Christmas treats that we spoke about a couple of weeks ago. I like turrón, for example, the soft turrón I like, and a few other things. But I also like the sometimes where you get dried fruit coated in chocolate. I like that.
Oh yeah, the figs are
Quite.
also very popular, yeah.
That's right, figs, and that you can buy ones that have got sort of like an alcohol center as well, which are quite tasty. And I enjoy those, but the polovidon, not really my style. No.
No worries, no worries. I think for one of our future videos, I will bring a polvoron and I will show you and the audience how to actually eat properly a good polvoron.
Well, you said you crush it all up and then eat it like that, right? Yeah, that's it. All right,
Exactly,
good.
exactly.
All right, good. What are we talking about today, Ivan?
Yeah, well, let's have a little bit of a catch up with the situation, with all the paperwork and the Seguridad Social, the NIE about my wife. Also, we took advantage last weekend to rent a car, drive towards the south. As probably you and your audience remember, we moved this year, and obviously my wife is not Spanish, so I'm trying to take any weekend as an excuse to discover a little bit and show her around.
Before the
So
borders close.
hopefully not touching good, but at least not the regional one this time. But you know, depending what kind of news and what kind of people do you listen to, Cantabria has been on the front light lately
Well,
with our.
you have a president that likes the camera, don't you? You see, so Mr. Revilla, I think his name is. He's always on the television here. He always pops up on the local television programs, trying to push a book or whatever he's written or his
Anything.
theories about different things.
Anything. I think he likes more the camera than the actual government offices.
And he always likes to push a type of brand of anchovies as well, which I don't know whether he owns the company or not, but he's always pushing that brand. Yeah,
Definitely, he is getting all the corporate tax from that company, that's for sure.
that's it, that's it, that's it, Mr. Revere. So where did you go, Ivan? Did you go where you went to Andalusia, did you?
Yeah, we rent a car. As everybody can remember, we live here in Madrid, so we rent a car and we head down south. We
Good.
stop by Almagro. There is a small little town, very touristic, in Ciudad Real. I think there's a few of your audience living in there or around that area. And Almagro is a small little town. It's quite touristy, but it's kind of like a niche tourist, let's say. So just to put a little bit of a, obviously, you know, comparisons are always hideous, but in this case, you have in the UK Shakespeare and the Glove and all that theatrical bit. In Almagro, we have the Corral de Comedias, which is like the old antecessor of theater here in Spain. And you know, the typical traditional construct of a building with a patio in the middle, various number of families living around on different floors, etc. And the peculiarity of this one in Almagro is that it was used as the first theater, basically, as they put the stage there. And Even today, they perform in there. So, yeah, it's quite interesting. Mm. And
they have a festival every year, I think, don't they? They have some type of festival in Almagro where they do some type of theatre there. And it is a popular tourist destination, I think more so than Ciudad Real, which is the capital of that area down there. And I think Almagro is one of the main tourist areas in the province of Ciudad Real in the province, that's it.
Yeah, exactly. It's the community of Castilla-La Mancha in Ciudad Real.
That's right. That's right. And you might stop at Valdepeñas and buy a bottle of wine or something as well.
You know me well.
That's it. A bottle of Valdepeñas. Yeah, it is. Well, it's all fairly close. Manzanares, Valdepeñas, Ciudad Real, Almagro, all close. That's it.
Exactly. And you can try berenjenas de Almagro, Almagro's aubergines. So it's kind of like a pickle.
A pickled aubergine, good. And also popular for cheese as well.
Oh, yes, you are in the La Mancha region, so, yeah, you know, just saying that, nothing else to add, really, so you like cheese, you know, you are in the right place.
There's always somebody looking to sell you cheese in La Mancha, that's right, yes, there's always somebody looking to sell cheese. Right, good. So you stopped off there, and then you went down further south, did you?
Yeah, we went to Cordoba, as I said.
Okay.
And trying to have any opportunity to see all the beauties around. And one of the first things that she mentioned when we arrived to Spain, you know, I went to visit the south. But you remember was summer back then, and I'm a citizen of the north latitudes, let's say. Yeah. So I say, well, maybe from September, October, we start talking about this because I cannot cope with 40 degrees weeks anymore.
No. Yeah. And Cordoba is a place that is incredibly hot in the summer months. That's it.
Yeah. Too hot for me. I was talking to a few locals and they were saying that this last summer, there was like 3 weeks in excess of 40 degrees. So not something that I want to experiment myself.
My girlfriend's family comes from Cordoba, so we visit them every now and again. And although I haven't been in the peak months of summer, I've seen the buildings there. They have a massive air conditioning units on the top of them, you know, to keep people cool. And when you talk to them, they say just you can't do anything from, you know, 11 o'clock in the morning to 8 or 9 o'clock in the evening, the peak of summer.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, probably that's the typical portrait that the foreign, the travelers, the tourists that the Spain sell outside, obviously, that is the typical postcard and the typical attitudes. But, you know, I wouldn't put myself. Imagine that you work in the construction or you are digging or on the field. Imagine doing anything at that time. So the only thing that you can do is like work very early on. You know, when the sun is hitting you straight, go for a siesta, go for a tapa, and then carry on later on. That's why maybe some of our cultural weird timetables come from. Who knows? Maybe that's another theory there.
Most likely that's it. That's where the siesta comes from. Too hot to work in the middle of the day, so have a couple of drinks and a sleep.
Oh, and I can tell you those drinks were amazing in Cordoba. good drinks, good food, nice people. Yeah. We saw a horse show. The Cordoba horses and the Spanish horses are mainly one of the main attractions from Cordoba, and they were using from very ancient times. I think they came from the Arab horse, and obviously, you know, that city Cordoba was the capital from the Al-Andalus, the Arab Spain, for a few centuries, so quite a lot of influence in there. It was beautiful place to be, to walk around, to discover the mosque, cathedral. Say hi to our guide, Olivia. We went into an English tour.
So maybe did you do a free tour?
No, it wasn't a free tour. It was a paid tour. We were in the La Mezquita, and then in the Barrio de la Judería, so the most traditional narrow street But it was very, very nice. Very, very good experience.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting city. That's it. Well worth a visit if you're in that part of the world. That's it. Good.
Absolutely.
And your wife enjoyed it?
Yeah, she did indeed. She did indeed. We didn't finish there, actually. We went to Granada.
Oh, you went somewhere else?
Yeah, we saw that Casado has been busy around Granada this weekend. So
so you went to pay your respects at the same cathedral?
No, I didn't. I was thinking about going because the Catholic kings, they are buried there in the royal chapel.
Really? Oh, okay.
Yeah, but we were too busy with the Alhambra and the tapas, and to be honest, that slipped my mind. And you know, we were saying that it's gonna snow, and the Sierra Nevada, you can see that there's still some snow there at the top, and it had been topped up with some snows lately, so the ski season might start very soon around there. So.
Well, that's right. If you go to Sierra Nevada, you want to see the Sierra Nevada, right?
Exactly, exactly that. Very good pronunciation of the double R there, Stuart.
thank you. Yeah. So you didn't go to the cathedral. You didn't coincide with Mr. Casado then, no?
No, I forgot my flag at home.
Well, it depends which flag. That's right. There's a different flag. There's a different flag for the 20th of November for some. That's right. So you have to be careful. All right, good. So Granada, the tapas are apparently brilliant there, right?
Amazing. That's amazing. The tapas were amazing, and just the quality and the quantity really as well. You can have a whole meal with a couple of rounds. We were asking to some locals, you know, go to this place for like fish based, and they were like the typical pescadito frito, cazón, obviously langostino, like prawns and little fish fried, etc. And there was other places that maybe do more like grill or charcoal meat as well. Just talk to people. Get the knowledge from the people around you, and I was surprised as well. There was quite a lot of English being heard in Granada and in Cordoba. Yeah, quite a lot. And in Cordoba, I remember there was we went for dinner, and I was listening to this American accent behind us, and obviously we talk ourselves in English on a daily basis. You can hear this. It was like a father of two, obviously, you know, the husband and wife and two little kids. He was trying to do his best to try to order in Spanish, and he asked things, and you know, he didn't get it quite right, but he was making the effort. And you know, I couldn't help but just congratulate him at the end of the meal and said, you know, please keep trying because you are doing a good job, and try to reinforce the message of, you know, talking to people in Spanish, you know, that's going to make their day and, you know, make your life easier in this country.
Did you find out, were they living here or were they just people just visiting or?
Yeah, they were visiting. They came from San Francisco, I think they mentioned, a few weeks here in Spain. So yeah, some people coming around. And again, obviously because of my wife, we have been doing all the Mezquita tour and the Alhambra tour in English. So yeah, quite a few of tourism coming around.
Yeah. Well, I mean, those two places that you mentioned there, Cordoba, Granada, probably two of the most popular places in Spain to visit, right?
I mean, 100%.
Andalusia in general, I think, is the tourist mecca for a lot of people, and there's just so many things to see. I remember somebody once said that if you're looking for value for money tourism or value-added tourism, Andalusia is a place, because you can go to basically every city in every region there and get a, and you know, maybe not Jaén. I don't want to speak badly about Jaén city, but that's probably the least known of all of the cities in Andalusia. Almeria maybe as well, I don't know, but the Granadas, the Cordobas, the Sevilles, the Cadiz, the Malagas, quite popular places.
Yeah, no, 100%. And even you remove in the main capital of the provinces, as that you have mentioned, you have the Úbeda, you have the Antequera,
Ronda.
Bailén, Ronda. You have quite a lot of very picturesque places. Yeah. A night of hotel around there is going to be much cheaper than in the capital, of course, for obvious reasons. And you're going to be treated as a king. Tapas, I remember having a fino in Bailén. I think it was 120 for the fino. There was 2 quid for the caña. So, you know, it was a little bit bigger than a caña. I don't want to offend anyone, but it was very, very good.
Was it a doble?
Yes, that was a doble.
Okay, all right,
and good. I discovered that Malaga has the Victoria Malaga beer that I didn't know.
Did you go to Malaga as well?
I didn't go to Malaga, but apparently many, many places, apart from the Alhambra beer that is very, very famous in Granada, they have another brand that I didn't know. Obviously, I have been away for quite a long, so do apologize if it has been around for a while. And the name of this beer is Victoria Malaga, and it was quite tasty. So I brought a few cans back to Madrid.
Well, I've seen it here in supermarkets. I think you can buy it in the big like Carrefour supermarkets and places like that. I think I've seen it online in Amazon supermarkets. So it is available. But the beer that you mentioned there, the Alhambra beer in Granada, of course, a nice beer. Cruz Campo is quite popular in a lot of Andalusia as well.
Yeah, probably Cruz Campo, not that much. But you can find it. And they are very, very focused or very particular to some areas. So it has a little bit of like the Vegemite. You might like it or you might hate it.
Yeah. Well, that is the characteristic about beer in Spain, isn't it? That different regions have a different brand, although the taste is quite similar. I mean, there's not a lot of difference between, in my opinion anyway, between Mau and Mau Cinco Estrellas and the typical lager beer, but you do get different brands all around the country. That's right.
Yeah. We have talked in the past as well that the microbrewery and other brands seeing the beer scene has grown so much.
I
think I might still miss a little bit, especially in winter time, a little bit of that pub ale being from the pump, not very cold, but again, especially in winter.
You don't get that variety of beer here on tap normally. No, exactly. That's right, unless you go to a specialist English bar that you can probably find in places that are on the coastal areas, you could probably find it. But in Madrid, you just get the typical lager beer on tap and that's it.
Yeah, exactly. I will find one of those pubs for another trip.
Absolutely. Good. So a fantastic trip to Andalusia. Now, you said that you're having some problems with the paperwork for your wife there, the social security and all of those things?
Yeah, it's just basically just taking forever. As we have mentioned a couple of times about the NIE, thanks God, we got the call from the police and apparently everything was okay. We had to book another appointment to go to Aluche, here in Madrid. That's where the police station dedicated to immigration is located. So basically to collect the NIE. And now from then on, now we can start with another hell of a lot of paperwork. So the first because it's not working, I need to put her as my beneficiary in the social security. So I'm working here in Spain, so I am entitled to like all the different benefits, like the health, public services, et cetera, because she is not working. And obviously, in the same case, if you have a kid, you can put your family and your direct family as your beneficiaries. So basically, inscribe her in the social health and all that stuff. So
she's not paying into the system, right?
Correct. So basically, you are entitled to have your direct family to be covered. Yeah. Obviously, they are living here, they are enjoying the things. I am fully employed, that's fair. And that took us 3 visits
to get that done.
It was a little bit of a pickle to resolve that different paperwork. Some people that accept one thing and or the other. you know, I don't want to repeat the same thing over and over again, but the thing that maybe surprised me the most is the public building, the Social Security building that we went into. It was kind of like close by, and they have this security card, like calling you by name, and you have to obviously pre-book by phone or online or whatever. So it was like this public building, like doors closed, and then you have been called by name. One tip, if somebody helped, because that was something that I discovered on the first visit, I went there with no appointment or nothing, because it was impossible to get one. And guess what? Yeah. Apparently, they made those slots available at midnight. So there was this couple of ladies saying that I have to call at 2 a.m. to get an appointment to the Social Security. Yeah. Yeah. And there was this other retired woman that I just wanted to change the bank account where my pension goes, and she couldn't do it. So it's just what it is. So any tip around there for anybody in the same situation?
Yeah.
Although I think it might not be the same outside of Madrid. I heard other people that outside of Madrid, they didn't have much of a trouble to get an appointment, to get things done. But here in Madrid especially, it's a little bit more tricky than usual.
Yeah, well, I think these services have become more difficult after COVID, of course, and the appointment system. Mm-hmm. I think that's been around for a while, but obviously now they probably don't want everybody gathering in the building, or there's space between where people sit and all of these things, which have come into play since COVID took off. And I remember last year there was a scandal because the social security numbers, when everybody was having problems, you know, losing their job and all of those things, I remember there was a problem with the appointment system that people were, I don't know whether it was the Social Security or SEPI or whether it's, you know, the difference between the two, but people were like getting bulk appointments and then selling them because of the demand, you know.
I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised, unfortunately. But on the other hand, you know, I wanted to leave it in a positive wonder. When we actually managed to get into the building to talk to somebody, we crossed paths to this public servant. Obviously, I don't remember the name. I don't think he ever shared it. But he was like super helpful, super helpful. Mm. He even tried to speak a little bit of English to my wife, because everything that he said on the phones I was reading or translating directly to her, so she is aware about the process and what are we doing there. And he even tried a little bit to speak in English. We mentioned a couple of doubts, because the appointment, they give you like this appointment for this thing. This is the cause that we need to even come back a third time. And we asked for the electronic certificate. I will talk about that in a minute. But this guy was super, super helpful. And you know, it's just praise for him, because there is still good people out there, good civil servant actually wanted to help people. And, you know, even though mañana is still out there for some, there is still people that really want to do the job, and they are productive, and they are very, very helpful. So, you know, praise and kudos to him.
Well, civil servants get a bad rap everywhere. I don't think it's unique to Spain, you know. But, you do find helpful people inside services, and I've had some good experiences and some bad experiences. The thing that's always annoyed me the most, especially back when I was going through the process of renewing residency and all these things, was the enormous queues that used to exist, because you could only go to two or three places when you were from outside the European Union, and one of them was the place in Alucha that you mentioned, which also happens to be where they hold the illegal immigrants as well, people that have...
That's it. It's half of a jail there. Yeah.
Well, it used to be the Carabanchel jail, right? So the part of it has been turned into like a place where they hold illegal refugees. And I remember we were waiting in the line one time there, and people were shouting out through the window, you know, help, help. And it was a pretty bad experience. But, you know, when you're standing in a queue for an hour, which was the minimum back in the day, I mean, it's a lot faster now. You just go to the local police station to get it done. But I remember having, you know, really long queues in places like Alucci and other places that you had to get your residency done at.
Exactly. We didn't have that experience. Well, I have been with her in all of this process, obviously to assist with the language barrier, just to make sure that everything was okay. Obviously, it's just difficult enough to get an appointment and to get at the top of the queue.
So you don't want to
miss your opportunity to get things done.
That's exactly right. And you said the certificate.
The third visit to the Social Security is that there is this thing called the Certificado Digital. When you are Spanish, your DNA, your DNI number, that is basically like the same as the NIE, but for Spanish nationals, you have like a chip, like a credit card chip in there that you can plug and you can do many things, okay? Online, basically, you can, I don't know, for example, you can ask for a copy of the Padrón or your change of residency. You don't need to queue anywhere. You just use your certificate to identify yourself on the internet as who you are. And then you change whatever you have to change as if you were like in front of the civil servant in charge of that service. So for me, it was paramount to get that done for her. So you are out there and, you know, you have gone through the settlement process, the NIE. I will strongly recommend you to get the electronic certificate because that will solve you a lot of headaches. It was commented with Nick as well, you know, when you buy a house, when you do your tax return, your declaración de la renta, for the health system. So you're in Madrid here. I think in other communities is similar. You can use your electronic certificate to ask for an appointment on the GP. You can get access to your history. So your medical history is in there. You have done some analytics, the information is there. For traffic or for your driving license, I haven't managed to fix that one yet. Maybe for another episode.
That's your next challenge.
So it's extremely useful.
Digital certificate, right? Okay.
Correct. Extremely useful. There's a couple of ways to do it with the DNA, especially if you are Spanish, obviously. With the Fábrica Nacional de Moneda y Timbre, the FNMT. Those of you that maybe you find some Spanish series like Money Heist, that is like the Casa de la Moneda. So that's basically where the euros being printed in Spain are from. They are in charge of this service. You fill a form online with your computer and the different identification, etc., etc. But in order to check that you are who you are, the final step is that you go to a public body, and in this case, the closest one to us, it was exactly the same Social Security office. The third one. So you have to go there with your passport. And one of the things is like, well, you thought that you have the NIE done, and you can forget the passport for inland Spain. You move around. That's the only document. So in order to get the certificate, you have to present your passport. It's not enough just to have the NIE. It doesn't matter if you have presented all sorts of paperwork, libro de familia, passport, you know, you name it. Yeah. You have to bring your passport again for that one. So don't miss that tip as well.
Bring your passport. All right, good. All right, good, Ivan. We'll start to wrap it up there. Good chatting to you again.
As always, pleasure to help, Stuart.
And we'll be in contact next week, I suppose, right?
Anytime, no worries.
If we can, even though we have a long weekend coming up, so it might get in the way, but we'll see. We'll see what happens.
I'm sure we can schedule something and enjoy the same holidays and the puente once again.
All right, good one, Ivan. We'll be in contact, okay?
Take care, Stuart. Stay safe.
All right, see you later. Good day. Bye-bye. Yeah.